What I would like to see the critics doing is not so much to take examples of the arbitrary use of the framework for control purposes, and as though they were typical, but rather to use the recommendation, which after all has been agreed to by all the member governments to whom it is addressed, and insist that the recommendations are carried out. That I would take to be a positive response rather than a purely negative and carping response. Because I don't think it is right to say, for example, I mean the some of the criticisms, the extreme criticisms, are laughable, really. I know in the early days there was the suggestion that if the framework was accepted, then all research in applied linguistics would cease. Recently, there is the criticism that it is just a response to petty squabbles about local squabbles about qualifications, or that it is an attempt to force everybody into a narrow mould where their arms are pinioned to their sides and they have no freedom of action. This is simply not the case. I think if people look carefully at the framework itself, and particularly the first two chapters in which the whole approach and ideology is explained, and then look at the nature of the recommendation in 2008-07 and the explanatory notes, and then use those as a way of ensuring that the highest standards of integrity and professional competence are maintained by the bodies that claim to be adhering to the framework, then I think that would be a very much more positive way forward.
I totally agree, but I think we still end up with the danger that people are looking for answers that aren't there. Now, perhaps that's a danger we can't deal with. For example, you want to know how to do it in your own context. So you have the common framework, which gives you a framework of reference, and then you're still looking for the answer. Well, so what? What do we do? How do I know how to implement the level system for my policies related to immigration? Or how do I do it in relation to my accepting people in my university or what have you?
Well, then what we hope will happen is that people looking for local solutions to their own problems will work hard and honestly and transparently to solve those problems and to produce a solution, and to then inform other people about what they're doing, how they're doing it, and what their decisions are, which then other people can use or modify or adapt to their own conditions. In that way, whereas the implementation questions that you're speaking of have to be faced and solved by particular institutions, governments and non-governmental, then the exchange of information using the apparatus of the framework or any other means that they find suitable for communicating with other people about their problems and their solutions will lead to a raising of activity all told.
And that highlights one of the noted advantages of the framework from the beginning is that it should provide metaphorically a common language.
Yes.
For addressing similar problems.
Yes.
But perhaps leading to different outcomes dependent on circumstances.
It must lead to different outcomes because the outcomes depend upon the local circumstances, which are different in each case. In order to apply the principles to any particular language, mm-hmm. and indeed to any particular group of learners of a language, at different stages and in different contexts, mm-hmm. A general framework cannot provide the answers to those questions. They must be worked at by the people who are responsible in those contexts.
Well, this is definitely made clear in the documents you've referred to, yeah. both in the framework and in the recommendations and notes that go with it. I think the user, though, is left with these dilemmas. You've got the one we've already mentioned, which is the general or common compared with the specific and local. The other one, which I think we're also moving on to, is the framework is a document which exists in time, 2001, and we're now 10 years on. To what extent is there, do you feel, as a user perhaps, that you can modify the framework? And to what extent should it be an evolution into the future? Because if you take it too far, you move away from its commonality, and it no longer has its value as something which is general and everyone uses it. So these tensions which are there are raising questions, I think, which people are struggling with. How do you feel about that?
Well, I would like to see the concrete proposals or the concrete analysis of shortcomings and concrete proposals for their correction or amelioration, mm-hmm. and I'm not aware of any.
Okay.
Because on the whole, the criticism has not taken those forms, mm-hmm. If the framework is to develop, it will develop as a result of how people find it operating in use, mm-hmm. and the changes which they will make in their own local situations, which, if they are sensible, will then be taken on by the community. I think it will develop organically in that way, mm-hmm. and not by a central fiat.
Right. So the process of using it,
yes.
will see its evolution taking place variously here, there, in different parts.
Yes, because if you take the RLDs, the reference level descriptions. Mm-hmm. These, which are undertaken for particular languages, mm-hmm. will show whether the categories that are represented in the framework are, if need be, wrong, mm-hmm. or inadequate for full working purposes and need to be elaborated and supplemented, amended, and that, if it is a transparent process available to the field at large, can then be used to guide other people in their local implementations, and then those things will become part of general practice.
Mm-hmm. Well, you've just raised an interesting example, the reference level descriptions, which is one of the projects which the Council of Europe continue to support in this field after the publication of the framework in 2001, along with a number of others which have, in a sense, seen an evolution of the framework, not within the document itself, but in the supporting materials,
yes,
which have been produced in a sense to help users to adapt it and adopt it effectively in their own context and for their own purposes. And this has been termed a toolkit. And there are various tools in that kit which have been produced and I think are still continuing to be produced. And in that sense, we have an evolution going on, even though the framework and its main frame of reference has stayed the same. Do you think that's going to continue?
Well, I would hope so. And I would hope that people who are faced with the actual practical problems of developing examination systems or tests of one sort or another for different purposes, including immigration requirements and so on, will look carefully at the toolkit before, as part of their work in their development work.
Mm-hmm. But the same caveats apply to the toolkit as to the framework itself.
When it comes to the basic global scales themselves, the self-evaluation grid, for example, needs to be very simple, because if it's over elaborate, then the individual learners to whom it is addressed will be unable to cope with it. What they require is fairly general, readily understandable statements of what they would expect to be able to do with a language at successive stages in their learning. And to take that scale and to make it detailed and detailed and elaborate as it could be would then produce something which was unfit for purpose. Of course, the global scales themselves are supplemented by breakdowns into different activities, breakdowns into the different aspects of proficiency, like accuracy, fluency, range, etc., and also broken down for individual activities and individual areas of competence, which can be looked at where such purposes are necessary. But what is clearly absent and has to be absent in that general framework is a statement of the organization of grammatical development, which has to be looked at separately for each individual language, sure, and even for different learner groups within a particular language. And I think it is quite likely that in the next few years, it is that aspect which will come back into much closer focus. Unfortunately, the major theoretical developments in linguistics over the last 50 years have not proved to be very helpful in that respect. We are still looking, and I don't think the work in a second language acquisition is as helpful to the learning situations in classrooms across the world as it might be.
Although perhaps that's moving forward in the
That's right.
Context and, where that's happening.
Good. Because what we need is knowledge and understanding. And the framework could only be produced in the light of the knowledge and understanding available to those particular authors at that particular point in time. And it's very much to be hoped that there will be an increased applicable theoretical development in the understanding of the real processes of linguistic development and linguistic interaction, which may then mean that somebody will then have to take undertake a radical reassessment of what is needed for the purposes that the framework has served. And there's no escaping the fact that the most significant developments in intellectual development are always unforeseen.
Mm. The black swans.
You don't know what are going to be the critical seeds of creative activity for the next generation.